Students, title of today's lecture is Scanning Probe Microscope. In short, it is also known as SPM. Today's lecture is organized like this. So first we will talk about the introduction of the SPMs. What kind of output we get from SPMs, their historical background, the instrumentation or the you can say the block diagram of SPMs, what are various kind of SPMs and their applications, principle of operation of SPMs. I'm also planning to discuss about one particular SPM equipment which is supplied by NTMDT and it is available in our department. So just an example, so the working of this equipment will be displayed or will be shown to the students during this lecture. Finally, we will conclude our discussion. So in today's lecture basically, so we are going to cover these points, and these three points they will be covered in the coming lectures. So first we are going to start with the introduction of scanning probe microscope. So scanning probe microscopes are actually a family of instruments used for the studying surface properties of materials. So there is a narrow tip, a probe which scans the solid surface of the sample, and the separation between the probe tip and the sample surface is very small. The separation is 10 to 100 angstrom, and because of this small separation between tip and sample surface, there are very strong interactions, and these interactions we have to study, and these interactions can give us lot of information about the sample surface. So the knowledge about the type and degree of these interactions, that is very important. If you know what kind of interactions are there and how strong these interactions are there, so once we get this kind of information, that information can be utilized to study the local properties of solid body surface. And whatever data we get because of these interactions, that data is collected and it is used to produce the image of the surface. So that way the interactions which are taking place at each and every point, so the interactions and some information we get from those interactions, that is stored in the computer, and then it is recollected to reproduce the image of the sample surface. Now the next point is, what kind of output we get, means what is the format of the output, right? So, or you can say how the output will look like. So output which we get from SPMs is this kind of 2D image. You can see here, this image is obtained from aluminium copper alloy. This alloy is deposited on silicon material. So all that film of aluminium copper alloy deposited on silicon is scanned with the help of SPM, and scan area is about 6 micrometer. You can see it's actually 6 micrometer by 6 micrometer. Right, this is also 6 micrometer, and you see here the resolution of image is very good. The features which we can see, they are very sharp features. You know that a film is not a continuous film, it is made of several grains and the grains are connected together. If we talk about scanning electron microscope, then it becomes very difficult to view the grains and grain boundaries so clearly. But in case of scanning probe microscopes, you can see the grains are clearly visible, their boundaries are very sharp, and we can identify the location of these grain boundaries. If you talk about the second image, this is moly oxide crystallites. They are lying on another moly oxide substrate. So this is substrate, and on that substrate these crystallites are lying here. So resolution, you can see it's very good resolution. So that way we get a 2D image, and the interesting thing is the resolution. So these crystallites are of nanometer dimensions, but if we look at these crystallites using scanning electron microscope, then it is not possible to see them so clearly. But in case of SPM, that clarity, that resolution is very high. Now we have to talk about the historical background. So you can see here, historically, if we something is missing here. Anyway, yeah. Anyway, so this direction here, this is time. Okay, yeah, this is timeline. Now, if we look at this timeline, in the beginning, near about year 1700, so the microscopes were available. And those microscopes were optical microscopes. So you can see the pic here, one example of optical microscope, and the resolution which was possible was about 300 nanometer, right? Now, after several hundred years, means in the last century only, a lot of developments took place in the science and technology. We started working in very small features, and then need arises to develop new techniques so that we can view and we can manipulate those small features and those small dimensions. And then new developments took place in the area of microscopy. So in 1931 year, tunneling electron microscope, this is very popular technique these days. This microscopy technique was developed, and this is the image of this TEM. It's very sophisticated equipment, and the resolution which was possible with this technique was 0.1 nanometer. And later in 1942, the time when India was fighting for its independence, and the Quit India movement was going on. So that time, the scientists, they were working, they were busy in developing scanning electron microscope, which is also very popular technique these days. And the resolution with this technique was 5 nanometer. You see here, the technology developed, but here you see the resolution was 5 nanometer, and here resolution was 0.1 millimeter. So you may ask, what is going on? Because we expect better resolution here. But the reason is, the scanning electron microscope is comparatively very simple technique. So tunneling transmission electron microscope is comparatively very complicated technique, and the sample handling and other kind of issues, they have to be done very carefully. While in case of scanning electron microscope, comparatively things are easy. So you can see here at this image, this is the pic of scanning electron microscope, and this is the pic of tunneling electron transmission electron microscope. So the technology developed, but the resolution here is 5 nanometer, and but still we are saying that the developments took place because the easiness of technique, that was more important, and scanning electron microscope offered a lot of simplicity as compared to transmission electron microscope. Later in 1981, scanning tunneling microscope was developed, and resolution here was very good, the best resolution so far, and it is about 0.01 nanometer. And later in 1986, again one more technique was developed, that is atomic force microscope, and resolution here was 0.1 nanometer. The same thing happened here also. You see here, after several years, we expected technology to improve. Definitely technology improved, but the resolution here is not as good as in this case. The reason is, the scientists and engineers were working in developing a technique which is more easy to handle. So the atomic force microscope is more easy to handle as compared to scanning tunneling microscope, and it was able to give a sufficient resolution also. So that's why AFM became popular those days. Now, these two techniques, STM and AFM, these two techniques are actually SPM techniques, scanning probe microscopy. Means there is a probe which scans the, probe is like a metal probe. So that probe scans the surface, and when it is scanning the sample surface, at each and every point, it is interacting with the surface. So the type of interaction and degree of interaction gives us lot of information about the surface of the material or surface of the solid. Now this photograph you can see. So the engineer, the scientists who developed scanning tunneling microscope, so they are working on this STM system, and they published their work in 1982 in Applied Physics Letters, right? And for this work, they got Nobel Prize of Physics in 1986. So Nobel Prize was awarded in 1986 for the development of this STM technique. So you can see that how important was the development of STM, that the Nobel Prize was awarded for its development. Now we understand the historical background also. So now we have to move to the next point, type of SPMs and their applications. Now the interactions between the probe tip and sample surface, they are not only one kind of interactions. Many kind of interactions can take place, right? So the interactions may be van der Waal interactions. You already know about van der Waal forces. The interactions may be carrier tunneling. The interactions may be magnetic interactions or electrostatic interactions. And this is not the limit. These are the most popular kind of interactions. There are many more kind of interactions. Each interaction can give you a new kind of information, right? So for example, you can see here, so the two techniques like a scanning tunneling microscope, this is one SPM technique, and second SPM technique, the most popular SPM technique is atomic force microscope. So if you talk about these two techniques only, so this STM, the working principle of this STM is carrier tunneling. So means tunneling of carriers takes place between probe tip and sample surface. If you talk about atomic force microscope, AFM, then the working principle is van der Waal interactions. This STM, if you talk about application, it is used for the surface topography of conducting samples. So we can study the topography of solid surfaces, but those solids should be conducting solids. If we talk about AFM, AFM also gives us information about the surface topography, but it can give us information about the conducting as well as for non-conducting samples, right? So you can see here, the type of interaction between probe tip and sample surface is different in these two. Depending on the type of interaction, we have one SPM technique. Depending on, for example, for van der Waal interaction, we have AFM. For carrier tunneling, we have STM. And depending on this SPM technique, we have a different application. So STM can be used for conducting samples. AFM can be used for conducting and non-conducting samples, both kind of samples. Now, we just talked about two members of this SPM family, means only two kind of SPM techniques we have discussed in the previous slide, but it's not only two, there are many kind of interactions and each interaction give us a new technique. So there is a list of several SPM techniques which are currently being used by the researchers to study the solid surface. This is scanning near field optical microscope. This is scanning near field acoustical microscope. Scanning ion conductance microscope. Like this, there are many techniques, but we are not going to discuss about all these techniques. We are focusing only on two popular techniques. One is STM and other one is AFM. So now we understand what kind of various SPMs are there and what are their applications. So our focus was only on two techniques. One was STM and other one was SPM. So we are going to focus only on these STM and AFM. So the next thing is we have to talk about the block diagram of SPM. The main components which are there in SPM equipment, so those main components we have to understand, or you can say we have to study the block diagram of SPM. Now the basic components in any kind of SPM system. So first we should have a solid material, or you can say the sample, solid sample and whose surface we want to study. Then there is a probe. This probe is very close to the sample surface, and then this probe, you know, we have to scan it, to we have to move it to each and every point on the sample surface. So for that purpose we have to attach a scanner to this probe, which will help in the movement of this probe. Then you know that the probe tip and sample surface, they will interact with each other. Some kind of interactions will take place. Maybe it is magnetic interaction, electrostatic interaction, van der Waal interaction, or carrier tunneling, or any other kind of interaction. So now what we have to do, we have to detect what kind of interaction is there, because only then we can get some information, only then we will be able to conclude the right information. So first we have to detect what kind of interaction is taking place between this probe tip and sample surface. So we should have a mechanism for the detection of the interactions, and once we detect the interactions, then we have some signal corresponding to that, and that signal should be converted into a electronic signal. So that is very important, because all that processing, data processing will be done electronically, and the information will also be displayed on some electronic equipment. Now once the information is converted into electrical signal, then it will be processed, it will be amplified, noise will be reduced, other things will be done, and then this information will be stored in a electronic circuit which is controlled by a computer. Now this is one part, that the interaction which is taking place here, that interaction has to be detected, it should be converted into electrical signal, that electrical signal should be processed, and then that information is stored somewhere in the electronic part, and all that part is controlled by the computer. Now we have to move this probe horizontally in x direction. For example, if this is x direction, right, this is our x direction. So now this tip have to move in this x direction, and it is connected to this scanner. So the x control lines will control the position of scanner. So once the scanner moves in x direction, this probe will also move. Now once the x direction scanning is over, then the probe have to move in the y direction. So this is suppose y direction. So we have to have some control lines for moving it in the y direction also. So there are y control lines which are connected to this scanner, and these y control lines are responsible for its movement in y direction, and x control lines are responsible for its movement in x direction. So that way the entire area of the sample surface is covered. Now scanning mechanism, two kind of scanning mechanisms are possible. One thing is that we can do the scanning by probe, means it means the probe is scanning the sample surface and the sample is stationary. The second method is we do scanning by sample, it means we keep the probe in the stationary position and we move the sample. Now let's see what are the benefits or disadvantages of these two kind of scannings. So if you talk about scanning by probe, that is very easy to do, but the problem is that the lateral movements of probes will involve in it. So if you are moving this probe from one point to other point, the lateral movements are there, and because of those lateral movements, oscillations may be introduced into the probe, and these oscillations will act as a noise. So whatever movement is there, that movement is going to be recorded, and if there that kind of unwanted oscillations are there, they will also be recorded, and that kind of unwanted information is a noise. So that way, if we are scanning by probe, then there are chances that some noise will be introduced into the system because of lateral movement of the probe. And if you talk about the scanning by sample, then these kind of unwanted oscillations are not present. So here what is happening, probe is stationary, so probe is stationary, and your sample surface, that sample surface moves in x direction or in y direction. So if you see the weight of this sample holder, it is relatively there is more weight in this, and the dimensions are also comparatively bigger than the probe. So because of that, when it is moving step by step in x direction or y direction, less oscillations or no oscillations are introduced in it. And since there are no oscillations introduced, we can say that the noise is less if scanning is done by sample scanning, and if noise is less, it means we can achieve better resolution. Now let's see here. So here this diagram, you see this diagram is almost similar to the diagram which we have seen just two slides before. The only difference is that the X control lines and Y control lines were there to the probe scanner, because there we were doing scanning by probe. But here in this diagram, we are doing the scanning by sample. So X control lines and Y control lines, they are going to the sample holder. Now in this case, the X moment and Y moment will be introduced into the sample holder, and sample will change its location. Probe will remain stationary in its position. So this scanning is scanning by sample, and in earlier case scanning was scanning by probe. So all other things are same. So here also we have to detect what kind of interaction is there. That interaction, some kind of physical signal is there, and that signal has to be converted into electrical signal, and then it will be processed further. Now, principle of operation. So what is the principle of operation of these things? So these things we will discuss in the next lecture. So today, what we have covered so far, we have covered about the introduction of scanning probe microscope. What is scanning probe microscope? What kind of output we get from scanning probe microscopes? Their historical background, about the block diagram of SPM, and we have seen what kind of SPMs and what are their applications. In tomorrow's lecture, we will study the principle of operation. I told you that we are going to cover two techniques, STM and AFM. So in tomorrow's lecture, we will talk about STM. We will talk what is the working principle of STM. And after that, in the next lecture, we will talk about atomic force microscope. So thank you very much. So if you have any doubt, any question, so you can interact with me during the doubt sessions. Thank you. Thank you very much.